Welcome to Virtual Primary Years Program Info Session. My name is Srishti Singh and I will be your host for today's session. On behalf of Candor International School, I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today. Candor International School is the first green school of India certified by Indian Green Building Council. All buildings architecturally constructed in such a manner that dependency on artificial light and air is minimal. Candor harnesses sunlight energy by installing solar panels in the school. Candor is self-sufficient in terms of water and uses the underground water resources. The school has 6 acres of organic farm, including dairy farm, and supplies 65% of vegetables and dairy products to Candor Kitchen. Candor is ranked India's number 5 in Bengaluru as an international day-come boarding school in the school rankings in 2020-21. It is also rated number 1 in innovative teaching. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them in the chat box. I'll bring them up at the end of the session. We are truly here as a responsible community. We do our best when we do it together. So this is a first good step in the direction of our children's future, which is our common objective. Now, I would like to call upon Ms. Kavita Sinha, our principal, to share her thoughts.
Good morning, everybody. Let's pray. We pray for your love and compassion to embody us as we walk through this challenging season. We ask for wisdom for those who bear the load of making decisions with widespread consequences. We pray for those who are suffering with sickness and all those who are caring for them. We ask for protection for all from the risk of virus. We pray for the misinformation to be curbed and that fear may take no hold in hearts and mind. May we also approach each day in faith and peace, trusting in the truth of your goodness towards us. Dear parents, to start with a prayer is something I believe is the need of the hour. We are all going through some kind of disruption in our daily life due to this pandemic. But when all around sorrow is there, there's a light of hope. And that light of hope is an assurance from a school which believes in open-minded policy. And that's Candor for you all. Candor's vision is to deal with each and every child individually. That individual attention is given. The doors of the teachers, the principal, and the admin staff is always open for your care, for your questions. At Candor, we believe that no partnership is complete till we have parents as partner in education. To take you further in details of how the PAYP program looks like at Candor, I will like my coordinators to take you through the session. I am there for any questions. You can put it on the chat box on the policy, on how we actually take advices, feedback. You can get back to me through your chat box questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Kavita Sinha, for your inspiring message. Now, let's begin with the PYP open house. I repeat, please keep yourself muted. And if you have any questions, please enter them in the chat box and I will take them at the end of the session. I would like to call upon Ms. Kiran, our PYP coordinator, to please begin with the session.
Thank you, Srishti. Thank you so much. Good morning, everybody. So here we go. You have seen our beautiful campus, lush green campus, the beautiful, lovely pets, which the kids, the teachers, and every staff member of Candor loves to have them around. So now here we go with the primary years program. It's important for us to know about the curriculum being handled in the school. So let me tell you, we are going to take you through our primary years program. So for the next coming 15 minutes, I will be taking you through this process. So as Srishti mentioned, so any questions or queries you have regarding this program, you please use the chat box. Feel free to ask the questions. Also, if you have, if you're not viewing the full screen mode, just to tell you, I know you'll be viewing it, but just in case, you can go to the right-hand side corner top, click on the view option, and you can see a few full view screen, and then just click on it. You can have a full screen view of this presentation. So as I told you, the next 10 minutes, we are going to interact with you. So it is very important for both of us to know each other. As Rishi introduced me, my name is Kiran and I'm the PYP coordinator here. So I would like to know my enthusiastic audience also here. So can you quickly describe yourself with three words? Can you just tell me about you and your personality just in three words? There is a link shared in the chat box. That is a Mentimeter link. If you click on it, you will be going to that question. You will have three boxes where you can write three words there so that we can view. We would like to know you. Just any three words which describes you and your personality. Just I'm sharing with you, just for an example, if it is with me, if I have to begin, I can say I'm ambitious, honest, committed. These three describes me and my personality. What about you? So, thank you so much, Rishi. I think you have seen how our audience are. So we could see the words, they show that they are enthusiastic, more curious to know. Thank you so much for letting us know about you. So without anything, wasting much of your time now, let me take you through this program. So before I take you through this program, I would like you to brief you about how the program goes, the session goes now. It will go in four segments. The first segment, we will take you through, we will brief you about International Baccalaureate Mission Statement. Actually, it is about what is the aim of this mission statement and what is the framework and philosophy of the primary years program in our second segment. And then we will be introducing you to our Candor's curriculum through the schedule and the routines. And the fourth segment will be the most colorful and the interesting because those are about events. And events are also an integral part of the child's learning. So without missing it out, we will take you through the events as well. And we'll take pride in sharing our timeline of our Candor School. Candor School was established in the year 2011. Then we applied for the primary years program candidacy in the year 2013. And we got authorized by the IBO, International Baccalaureate Organization, to run and implement this program. And we are very proud to share with you that last week and this month, this May 5th, 6th and 7th, we had gone through our first evaluation also, which means the team of evaluators from IBO has come to look into the practices we are implementing it. And we got a good reviews and they have told us to keep up doing the such good work with many more innovative and creative ideas. That's a brief timeline of our school. Now we begin our first segment, understanding what is IBO, International Baccalaureate Organization. The mission of this organization is to, as you see on the screen, they aim to develop inquiring and knowledgeable and caring young learners. We call learners because it aims to create them into lifelong learners so that they create a better and a peaceful world for their generation. And that will be through intercultural understanding and respect. And to run this program, this IBO collaborates with the schools across the world. And they develop challenging programs so that the children will be grown into lifelong learners. And it also encourages the children to become international minded as well. And if you look at the other side of the screen, we have our school mission statement as well, which is very much aligned and speaks the same as the IBO mission statement says, that Candor also aims to nurture the young learners who grow up to respect the intercultural understanding using technology and creativity and collaboration as well. And we aim to develop them into lifelong learners as well so that they create the same peaceful and a better world for their generation. So this is the aim of having the primary years program. A little one more word about IBO. International Baccalaureate Organization is a non-government organization and it offers three programs. That is diploma program, for the ages 16 to 18. It has middle year program for the age 11 to 15. And it has primary years program from age 3 to 10. And now we are taking you through the primary years program, which starts from age 3, that is from pre-K to grade 5. We go with the program called primary years program. So on the screen now we are viewing the two logos. Little bit confusing, what is this about? It is not a map, it is just a curriculum model of the PYP. This curriculum model talks about what is this curriculum going to achieve, what is the students going to achieve from this curriculum, what is the outcome of this program, is what clearly depicted in this logo. So as I told you in the mission statement, the aim is to create the peaceful learners. That means they have to be international minded people. So to make them international minded people, our entire curriculum will be falling under 6 transdisciplinary themes. If you look at the second concentric circle, you can read it out who we are, how we organize ourselves, sharing the planet, where we are in place in time. These are the names or the titles of the themes which are run or which runs for it, which goes for a duration of 6 weeks from grade 1-5. The same program runs for early years as well. And for early years, it goes for 8 weeks. Much about the earliest will take in the next session in the coming slides. Let me finish with this, our grade 1-8 learning framework. So this is about 6 transdisciplinary themes under which the child will be inquiring through different subjects. You can see the disciplines given here, that is physical, social, and personal education, that is PSP, what we call in short, languages, of course, they play an integral part in learning. Then social studies, mathematics, art, and science. So name a subject and it is always there in that. So PYP focuses very much into a transdisciplinary learning, making sure that no subject is missed out. Every subject is being dealt at their own pace. Then after learning this, what is the outcome of this? The child will be able to apply the knowledge in his day-to-day learning. He will start thinking, he starts making connections, and he starts thinking about the issues and what best he can resolve it, how he can be a part of the resolution as well. And if you see an arrow mark which is coming out, that talks about agency. Agency here, it is about the student, making the student-centric learning. How can we make it a student-centric learning? It's by giving him those opportunities, that platform where he can make choices, where he can voice out, where he can share his opinions. When he starts making his choices, when he starts voicing out his opinions, he becomes the owner of his learning. So in short, agency helps the children to partner with their teachers in their learning. They're very much into the learning. They know what they're learning. They know how they're learning. They know how best they can learn. And when we are giving them a platform to make a choice, voice, so definitely their self-esteem will be raised high and they don't hesitate. They don't feel shy in making mistakes, accepting it and working on it. That's the beauty of this program, where every opportunity is given to the child to grow in all the aspects of his learning. To support this learning, we have three strong pillars. That is the learner itself, the one who is the center of this learning. Learning and teaching, all those practices and the resources connected with his learning. And the learning community, the people who are directly or indirectly involved in his learning. So these three pillars put together support the learning, and that is called as agentic learning. So that's a brief thing about our primary years program. And now, beautifully told you about this process, and also let me also tell you how is this put into practice at Candor. So to understand that, we need a schedule. So here we are showing you our virtual timetable schedule. We have a 10-day cycle. We are following a cyclic timetable because in case if there is a holiday falling on any working day, for example, if Monday goes on a holiday, the child will not miss any learning which has planned for Monday. In fact, if that Monday is falling on day 4, the next day of it will be continued as day 4. So there is no skipping of learning happening just because of holidays. We are not taking them as excuses or reasons to skip the learning. So to make the learning ongoing, the flow to be continued, we are having a cyclic planner, which goes for 10 days. Now, this is a virtual learning. So we also have taken care about the learning program, how it should happen. We thought giving more stress to our children as they have to sit before the screen hours together. So we have reduced their screen time learning, but we have balanced between screen time and off-screen time. The screen time is called as synchronous. The off-screen learning is called as asynchronous. So for if you say pre-K, the young learners, I can say the toddlers, they will be coming weekly twice, for a schedule of learning from the teacher. K1 and K2 will be having three synchronous classes. three synchronous classes and three asynchronous classes, which are again balanced, giving them alternate space. I will share the timetable with you as well. Grade 1 and 2s will have the four synchronous classes and four asynchronous classes. Grade 3, 4, 5, as the grade says, a little higher, so one class extra is needed for them. So we have given five synchronous classes and three asynchronous classes. That is a skeleton of the timetable. What does our timetable consist of? All the subjects. We have English, we have math, we have science, social, second language. In second language, we offer three languages, Hindi, Kannada, and French. They can choose any one as per their convenience. Then we have language of acquisition. Kannada as regional language is must by the government. So we have made it as an acquisition language, which means kids will be introduced, the students will be introduced to the language. Emphasis will be more on listening and speaking, and reading and writing falls later. If the child is ready to take it up, we are ready to offer. But acquisition is basically introducing them to that regional language if they are new for that place and new to the language. Then we have dance, music, PE, ICT, art, mindfulness, STEAM, and the drama class. This is same across all the grades. So we have divided all the subjects for entire 10 days between synchronous and asynchronous classes. This is our timetable, the sample we are showing you here. If you say, look at the color coding, let me help you out here. The burgundy color, it is synchronous. That is a screen time and it begins at morning 9:05. So sharp 9 o'clock, the teacher will open the classroom and we will be there waiting for our students to enter the classroom. And let me also tell you, our classroom is on Google Meet and Google Classrooms. Along with this Google Meet and Google Classrooms, we do also have Zoom links with us, Zoom classroom meetings also. In case we have special events or assemblies, or we have to collaborate with the grades, we go for the Zoom classrooms as well. Otherwise, the regular classrooms are conducted in the Google Classroom and Google Meet. So this is 9:05 synchronous class. It goes for 35 minutes. Then the child goes for a break of 10 minutes or 20 minutes for a breakfast. Then again, the class begins. It's again a screen time for him, 35 minutes. Then immediately after that, he has an off-screen time. Off-screen time is absolutely no need to come on the screen. Another, he can sit and watch the videos. Off-screen is completely off-screen. He will be given a task either to read or to write or to listen or to converse with the parents, have some communication. That's the only thing he will be doing off-screen, which is very much connected with the classroom learning. Then again, 11:10 to 11:15, it's a transition break. It means from asynchronous to get into the synchronous class, we are giving him that 5 minutes preparation just to stretch out and be ready for the next lesson. So the next lesson, 11:15, will be going to be his synchronous class. This is how the timetable grows with the lunch break in between. And then again, synchronous and asynchronous. The class timetable we have given up to 3:20. This is off-screen time. Teacher is available in the class from morning 9 to 3:20. If at all child needs any hand-holding, extra support, he has any doubts to be clarified, teacher is always available in the class. So the child can always come and he actually comes and clarifies his doubts, any extra work is given. Our teachers also use this time to get extra hand-holding for the children who need that extra support in learning. Or any feedback has to be given, that is also done in this time during asynchronous hours after 2:45. Along with this, we also have additional learning support team with us, who also helps us, a team of 5 members with student counselor, student psychologist, and learning support team. All the teachers together, along with the class teachers, collaborate and plan and design the learnings in such a way that no child is left unattended or unaddressed. So every child is given equal importance, equal opportunities so that he can learn. Maybe the learning can be in a different way, the process will be different, but the learning always happens with the child. So that is also taken care. So this is the timetable I would like to share with you, which talks about synchronous and asynchronous classes. Now you'll be having a question about teachers as well. So I just want to add up here, all our team members are qualified, fully trained. They come with a lot of experience and a lot of qualification required for the teaching process. Along with that, when they join the Candor family and the organization, we take them through a rigorous PD sessions. So we will be taking them towards required amount of PD sessions where they will be taken through the policies, SOPs of the organization, along with the implementation of the program, understanding the planners, understanding the process, And also they will be taken through certain policies like child safety policy, which is very important and mandatory for every staff member before they take up the class. Certain norms and requirements of the school also will be shared with them. Not only in the beginning of the academic year, but the PD sessions for the teachers continue timely on Saturdays on the break times, because unless we don't update ourselves, it's difficult to catch the pace of these new learners. So we always train our teachers as per the required hours, so that the program, so that they can update themselves with the program. That's about our timeline. That's about our process, what is going to happen. So I've been talking about, I've been telling you about how this is going to happen along this learning. I just wanted to take you through one of the learning engagements of the grade four to understand how the learning exactly happens in the classroom. What is this inquiry-based learning? Where it begins, how it goes, how is the child involved? So many questions for all of us. So we'll just take you through that. And this is how the learning platforms. We have Google Meet, Classroom, and the Zoom. I would like to add one more thing here before I take you to grade four. Because it is a virtual learning, we do have ICT plays a vital role in this learning. It's because all the reflections, the feedbacks what the child has to give, submission of the work, everything happens online. Though they write in the notebooks, they do have the notebooks, they write it, they take the screenshot and send it to the teachers. Along with that, they should be introduced to certain tools so that they can use the tools as well to use the to share their reflection and the learning with the teachers and their peer groups. So before the tool is given to the children, our ICT teacher takes the classes at least one or two to make them understand the form of the tool, what is the tool use it for, the function of the tool, how best they can use it, and also the ethics of the tool as well, before they actually start using the tool in the classroom. That's also about our virtual classroom learning. So here we have a journey. I'll be taking you through this part into our grade four learning. We are sharing our grade four learning journey with you. So may I request Ms. Usha to play the video, please. So this journey will help you to understand what exactly is the inquiry. How do we go? How do we begin? Where do we begin? How does the children understand? Maybe you will be finding big jargons in this inquiry, but we make it very simple for the children to understand, and then we take it up. So the unit what you're going to see, as you have seen, it is about government systems. It's a bit of a dry topic, but you will see how exciting our children have gone through that journey. So before we begin our unit, we do have a planner. So our teachers collaboratively sit, discuss with a team of teachers of all the subjects, as I told you, our transdisciplinary learning, which means going across the subjects, learning through different subjects. So all the subject experts, along with the HRTs and the coordinators, sit together and design the learning, how to take it further. So first they design, why are they going to learn? What is it they're going to learn? Why should they learn about government systems? That is the word called central idea, the big picture of learning the word government systems. Why is that they should learn? Because they want to understand how it is influencing people, under which theme, transdisciplinary theme they are learning. This is how we organize ourselves. The theme, it talks about interconnectedness, it talks about organizations, it talks about human-made systems. So they do a lot of planning how to take the unit. Now, next slide, Ms. Usha. This is the transdisciplinary theme and the description. So we begin the unit first understanding the key words of the theme. So if you see the words which are underlined, this is about interconnectedness, human-made system, and communities and societal decision-making. These are the keywords children have identified. These are not by the teacher. Teacher projects it. So whichever word I feel is a keyword for me, I will underline it and I'll start brainstorming on it. Yeah, next slide, Mr. Shah. So once the class discussion begins, then we use a tool. The kids start, students will start writing in their notebooks, as well as we also have here a Padlet. We use Jamboard, different tools to record their learning, record their reflection. So you can see the question given by the teacher. Why do we have organizations? Can you give some example of organizations, or what is the function of organization? These questions are provocation questions for the children to begin to get tuned in into the inquiry. So we just collect their information to understand where they stand in their learning. That's like a pre-assessment for our students. Next slide, Ms. Usha. Yeah, we can go to the next. Then again, this is a picture provocation unit, a previous one, Ms. Usha. This is a picture provocation, a learning engagement where we show them a picture. We ask them to see observe, think, connect, and add. So if you can just read one of the two quotes beautifully written there, somebody called Arav Gupta. He says, I see old 1,000 rupee note and I connect that the government has changed the currency 2 or more times. And then what he wants to add is the government has changed the note due to black money issues. You can see the words they're using, black money issues, currency, and the change in the currency. So this is how we collect their prior information. Next slide, Ms. Sushta. That is how they get tuned into. Then we will make them understand, why are we learning this? We are learning this unit to understand different forms of government, risk functions, and connection. We will connect them through our concepts. That is a conceptual understanding, what we call conceptual learning is the key element of this primary years program, because concepts give the depth of the learning rather than a shallow learning, abstract learning, which doesn't get retained with the students. Next slide, Ms. Usha. So these are some slides, how the children were brainstorming on the central idea. A question is given to them, understand what is their understanding about the central idea. So they start giving their information as well. Next slide, Ms. Usha. Then we will be showing them certain videos so that they get the first-hand information about what is this government, what does it do, what is the function of a government. So once they watch the video, before watching the video, a task will be given to them that they have to reflect on their understanding and observation. Next slide, Ms. Usha. So once they watch it, this is how they start reflecting. Not only the videos, we do give them some handouts and articles, some information so that to read. Now, because this is a virtual, we also have given them a virtual library where they can actually get into the virtual library. They can read the books virtual, the soft copy. When it comes to the physical, we do have a vast library. They can just get into the library to browse, to read, to collect, to research. That's how the learning happens in PYP. So once they read it, they start analyzing it, they start making their notes, and they start sharing their understanding, because reflection goes hand in hand with the learning. Yes, Ms. Usha, next one. This is about the unit again. So they have begin from local to global, as we say. So they're first learning about our government, they learned about it, and then they start understanding about the other forms of government across the world. So there's some of the learning engagements. Yes, Ms. Usha, these are the classroom discussions you can see. Then connected with the drama, as I told you, we go across the subjects, connected with the drama. They were actually role playing the, you know, different forms of governments, how it looks. They are sharing their understanding in that way. Next, they were using the ICT tools, as I was telling you. You can see the map pointing having done on it. The scratch tool, they were using it to share their understanding and forms of government. Next. Then the assessment go hand in hand for us. So assessment are not stressful for us, but assessment mainly for us to understand the understanding level of a child, where he stands and where he has to go. To measure his learning, assessments are ongoing for us. And other class activities where they go back and they connect the learning with the parents as well. Some of the interviews they share with all of us. Next. They post all this learning in their Google Classroom. Yes, Rona, these are the students' work samples we wanted to share. So after understanding the government, now they are coming to the second line of inquiry to understand functions and the responsibilities of the government. So the reflections, as I told you, they will write on their notebooks and just share the screenshot with us. So writing emphasis is more in PYP as well. They need to write, they need to collect the information. They have to analyze, they have to reflect, everything goes in writing. And before going to writing, they have to read a lot. So reading and writing is inseparable and goes parallelly with the inquiry. So inquiry is not only doing hands-on and hands-on, a lot of reading and writing is needed also. Next, Ms. Usha. This is their research work. And our units, we do bring our expertise. We do bring guest speakers from our own school, our own people. Any parent can be a guest speaker. Or we do bring some experts from outside as well, guest speakers from other schools as well, from other countries if needed for us. We do call, because guest speakers, expertise talk is very much needed. And also the field trips. Physical environment, we do go for field trips. Here we had virtual field trips also as well. Yes, Ms. Usha. Then as I told you, subject integration, you can see one sample we have put you here, how the language integration has happened. So the Hindi teacher has taken a chance going into the class, teaching them some vocabulary in our national language. The same did with our regional language, Kannada teacher, teacher for Kannada language. And the French teacher also has taught them some of the vocabulary. Then we have this practice of reflection. Because this is the reflection, as I told you, it is very much needed and it is an ongoing process. And every day class, we end the class with a reflection. And then This is another learning engagement, how the language English is being taken care of by teaching them the persuasive writing. And the inquiry, what we are seeing here is for grade 4. This is a grade 4 sample I'm sharing with you. This is all about writing again. How do you persuade the people? How do you convey your message to them? This is all about the writing skills. Next slide, Ms. Usha. So the how do they, now this is also a practice to make them understand the form and the responsible functioning of the government. We also have tried to bring in our class elections also as well. So you can see the persuasive writing done by the students. How to persuade, how to convince the people to choose them as a leader. So they have just written what is that they're good at and why they have to be chosen as a leader. This is one of the logo. What you see is A by the picture is a logo of their designation they want to show to the people. Next slide, Ms. Usha. Then this is elections process here, fully democratic way. So they have done the elections, campaigning, then they have the voting system. And this is how the mathematics is connected here. They have taken the data and they have represented the data beautifully on the graphs. And they have, along with the percentage, their leaders were chosen. This is about classroom elections as well. That's a representation of our representatives. Next slide, Ms. Usha. Then after that, it is very important for us to connect our learning with the real world. So they were given some case studies to understand, okay, government system, you have understood functions and what are the rights? Why are they important? And what happens if human rights are violated, child rights are violated? So they have given some case studies of some countries and they have done the case study and they have given their, what do you call, solutions, their ideas very beautifully in the next slide. Can you just have a look at, yeah. So this is a class discussion going on those case studies. It is not a one day program, it's a weekdays program. So they discuss, they come back, they reflect, they again go back, they add to their notes. This is how the learning goes in a cyclic process. Can we go? These are all our virtual learning classroom discussions happening. And then we have told them, okay, you understood the functions form of a government. Can you design your own government? How you want your government to be? So what is that one wow factor in your government systems which attracts the people, which understands a government functioning system? So they have looked into the scheme. They have come out different schemes for the people. I would like to have this scheme out. I would like to have one example, the goal, what is a digital technology to reach out to everyone? So that should be the goal. That is the goal of one of our students. So he has planned a scheme, how to make a digital learning available to everybody in the world, in the country. That is the action taken ideas. So our learning ends by the taking action of the students. Taking action is not exactly demonstrating it somewhere. It is a one thought, one connect. Is also action taken. So we value that thought, we value the participation of the student in any of the issue, either directly or indirectly is also valued. It's also considered as taking action because he has started connecting it to the people. That's how, this is a beautiful journey of our learning. Can we go to the next? So this is how the art integration happened during the learning. They were representing their thoughts in the art along with the writing as well. This is a sample. Then at the end of the unit, every child has to reflect on his learning. So we will be giving them an opportunity to what skills they have enhanced, what skills they have developed and demonstrated. And also along with that, what is the most interesting process they have learned, they enjoyed in this, and what is it one challenging thing they have faced and the areas of improvement. So everything put together is the reflection, very well documented. That's again, a beautiful document to go through for the teachers, how the journey went on and where the child has felt difficulty, where the child has enjoyed. This helps us to develop our coming unit of inquiries as well. This is the brief journey about our unit of inquiry in every grade. This is a sample of grade 4 I have shown. Thank you, Ms. Usha. Give me a minute. So. This is the slide which talks about PYP exhibition. This is most important are required learning stage in grade 5s, because PYP ends, primary years program ends at grade 5. So before they go to the middle school, all the grade 5 students have to go through this process of exhibition, a kind of an assessment where they will be given a chance to demonstrate the entire learning skills, what they have learned, and the skills, the attributes, and also they will be demonstrating how the action is being taken. So they start looking at the issues and opportunities and the challenges the world is going through it. So what part of theirs can be contributed for such things is being beautifully demonstrated in the exhibition. And just recently, I think last month, we had our PYP exhibition of grade 5s, and it was live on the Facebook as well, and everything was virtual. So the discussions, the collaboration, everything happened virtually one-on-one. It was a bit stressful, tedious for kids, but they enjoyed doing that process, because lots of learning, lots of field trips, virtual field trips, guest speakers come in, they share their expertise. So a lot of learning goes into this. So I request Ms. Usha, if she can share the teaser with our audience. I hope it will be great for them. Just to give them a glimpse of how the PYP exhibition looks. And the end of the exhibition, we will be definitely giving them the feedback and feed forward as well, which is also an integral part of our inquiry. Yeah, so here we have a teaser of exhibition. So kind of a gist of the exhibition. What is that about? So at the end of grade 5, the PYP journey ends, and it also tells us that children are ready to take up the next level of learning, that is in the middle years program. Here we go.
Process of the PYP Exhibition 2021.
Our transdisciplinary theme for the exhibition is Sharing the Planet.
I think sharing the planet is appropriate to the events going on now. We want our herd to have equal opportunities, peace and conflicts resolution. What do you say, Prem?
Yes, Mahesh. Sharing the planet is also about how we look after the world without inequalities.
We, along with our mentors, co-constructed our central ideas and lines of inquiry. This was most challenging yet exciting exercise. It helped us craft our own learning.
Our exhibition inquiries are also connected to the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. We dug deeper into SDG 15, Life on Land, SDG 14, Life Below Water, SDG 13, Climate Action, SDG 5, Gender Equality, SDG 3, Good Health and Well-being.
We have had many learning opportunities like guest speakers, online research, books, field trips, interviews, surveys, and news articles. We have gathered a higher understanding of our topics.
Virtual takeoff to Havelock Island, Andaman, to understand the significance of these fascinating creatures.
Virtual field trip to Parivartana, a recycling unit in Christ College, showed us wonderful ways to recycle paper.
I recently read an article about changing crop systems and making it more sustainable than reduce water care by Upmanuda. It's also connected to our community inquiry. And we are here at Kingly Hills to find out the advantages of the farm. To know more about it, stay tuned for the PYPX video.
The entire journey has helped us develop skills for a lifetime, and we are all excited to meet you on 29th and 30th of April at PYPX 2021. Thank you.
Thank you for playing that video. So that's about PYP journey, which is ending at PYP exhibition, but this is not the end of the journey. I would like to invite our earliest coordinator, Ms. Rona Rose, to take you further into the earliest program. I can see a lot of questions about earliest in the chat box. I think Ms. Rona is the right person. Over to Ms. Rona.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Ms. Kiran, for taking us through the PYP program. And my dear parents, I hope that you have gained a lot of insight about the PYP program. And I will be helping you understand how the program is carried out in the early years. Now, when you talk about early years, I'm talking about 3 to 5 years old, which is from pre-K to K2. And the earliest, it's very much part of the IB program, like as Ms. Kiran was talking about the IB program, we do follow the same format in the early years also. And we help them develop, like we help them focus on more on a play-based learning, where they learn to make sense of the world around them, since the children are naturally curious and they tend to ask a lot of questions. They come up with a lot of questions. And how do we do it? How do we answer all their questions? They come with a lot of excitement also when they ask these questions. So, of course, you know how we answer their questions? It's through play. We focus on play-based learning in the earliest. When I say play, I don't mean that they will be sitting and playing and it's just a play. It's not like that. We create opportunities for our students to have a hands-on experience through play, because when kids experience learning, it stays in their mind and it helps them to connect with the real world around them. That's what we offer at Candor, Ms. Kiran. Now, the next slide, I will be taking you through how we are doing it in a virtual setting. You might be wondering, oh, they are just 3 to 5 year old kids. How will they settle in this virtual setup? But our timetable is placed out in some way that we do. It's a blended learning that happens. We have 3 synchronous class and 3 asynchronous class. As Ms. Kiran already mentioned, synchronous means they will be online with the teacher, and the other 3 classes, they will be offline doing, engaging themselves in some hands-on activities. So we also use the Google Meet where teachers connect with them online. So from morning 9 o'clock till evening 3:20, the teacher, the homeroom teacher is available in the Google Meet. So if the child during the asynchronous class, which is the offline class, if the child has any doubt or if they want to connect with the teacher, they can always log into the classroom to meet with the teacher for 5-10 minutes to chat with the teacher. So that's how we build the bonding. So I saw the chat box of somebody asking, like, how do you initially settle them? Of course, initial hiccups will be there, but then parents are very supportive in that case, like for the young learners, for example, to unmute, to turn on their video, they need little support. What I can tell you now is I can see our K2 learners, 5-year-old kids, they are individually sitting, most of them. They know how to mute the microphone. They know when to turn off their microphone. So they are well equipped with that. They have just adjusted with the system. I think kids more than us, they get well acquainted with the system in no time. That's what we have seen actually. So even our pre-K learners, they are very excited. Like they like to come to class every day, almost every day they want to come to class. They are excited. Though it is at 9 o'clock, they are in their comfort of their home, but still they wake up, they get ready and they come for their classes without crying, without cribbing. So how we settle them down is during, like we have circle time, we have one-on-one interaction. The homeroom teachers make sure that they have one-on-one interaction with their kids. So we sing a lot of song to get them acquainted to the class. We do a lot of, we allow the kids to talk so that they get connected. And then we meet them one-on-one, we give them individual attention also. First, we learn to know what their likes and dislikes, and we ask them to share, we initiate conversations with them so that to make them feel comfortable. So of course, I'm happy to say that we have been running since the pandemic. Our kids are so happy and our parents, existing parents, are very happy with the way our program is running as of now. Next slide, Ms. Kiran. And one more thing I want to tell about the timetable is, if you see the asynchronous class or these classes in the afternoon, our teachers meet with the students individually on a weekly basis, so that it's not to discuss only about the academics, but to have a emotional connect also with them, because kids these days, they are, their well-being also had to be looked into. So our teachers connect with them personally also. So what are we learning? We are focusing on transdisciplinary learning, which means connecting all subjects. It allows the students, the transdisciplinary learning allows students to make connection across all the subjects. So no subject is taught individually, but along with the unit, all these subjects are being taught together. Why we are doing this? So that English is not taught as standalone, math is not taught as standalone. They need to know the connection between English and math. They need to know the connection between math and art. They learn to connect between subjects, all the subjects. And that's how they transfer their learning to make real world applications. So this is one main aspect that we focus on across the PYP and in the earliest through play. Actually, most of it you see, what I will be taking you, students are involved in an experiential learning. The next thing, to create a play-based environment, Ms. Kiran, next slide, please. To create the learning space is very important. To create a play-based learning, the learning space plays a major role. So the atmosphere that we create is very important. It has to be inviting for the learners. So we create learning space so that they are like, we are giving an invitation to them. We are not telling them, go play. By looking at the learning space only, they should be willing to go explore and experience their learning. If you see the pictures on screen, it all talks about the different learning spaces that we have created in our school premises. Those are virtual, physical pictures. So all those, see, they have different, they go to the ICT lab. They are learning how to, learning the formation of the letters using that board. And they are doing some hands-on activities to learn more about numbers. And we have created a learning space for them to, when they were learning about transport, they were learning how does different signs and symbols work. And then when we have an outdoor space also, we use our outdoor space very, very much. So over there, the kids are learning how to measure these shadows. This is in a physical setting. You might be asking, what about the virtual setting? Next slide, please. So in the virtual setting, in the beginning of the year, to make the kids comfortable, and the first and the foremost thing that we did was to make them create a learning space in their homes. So our kids learn to create a learning space at their home so that their classes are not being distracted. So our kids, they shouldn't be distracted. So their learning space are created in one corner so that there is no disturbance. Now, apart from this, what they did, next slide, please. What they did in their homes, this is again the physical setting where different, you can see the kids are engaged in all hands-on learning experiences. They learn numbers, they learn alphabets, they learn how to frame sentences by the end of K2. They are well versed with, they even write short paragraphs about a story or an object that they see. They learn how to write sentences. And right formation of the letters are being insisted when they join K1. Of course, in the pre-K, we do a lot of fine motor skills, which I will be taking you through, which sets the base for the handwriting. So we teach them handwriting, which means the formation of the letters. Next slide, please. And even in their homes, see, they have created learning environments. They have created their own learning spaces. So with their toys or with their blocks, whatever. So they have, like in the physical space also, we have a wide spectrum of resources. We even have a playroom in our early years, especially exclusively for our early learners, like to explore and experience their learning. Next slide, please. So how are we doing literacy and writing? Now, to develop, first I will talk about how we are enhancing their reading skills. Of course, we will be doing a lot of action songs, phrasing and everything, but I will first talk about how reading is being enhanced in our early years. Now, to develop the reading skills in our students, we have created grade-wise digital library for our students, which will be shared with them in their Google Classroom. Any work that we have to post, the synchronous or asynchronous, synchronous work that they have to do will be posted in their Google Classroom. Now, the same wise, the digital library is also posted in the Google Classroom. Now, they have year-long access to the online books, and we keep updating the books in a timely manner. Now, we also have included the Oxford Reading Tea program in our learning, which goes up to grade 2, wherein the books will be sent to the students every cycle, and then followed by reflection questions. See, what they read, we need to understand whether the child is able to comprehend. And according to grades, we send the books. It's like they get picture books, they get, when they are ready to read, they get three-letter word books. And when they are a little bit advanced, they get an advanced book to read. So they have an option to choose as well. So we do differentiation over there. Not each child is in the same level. So we give differentiated books as well. So these Oxford Reading Tea, which is called as the ORT books, will be sent, and then they post their reflection in the Google Classroom so that we know how much the child has understood or whether the child has read the books. Next slide, please. And when it comes to writing in the English, so we do formation of the letters. So before we do Ms. Kiran, if you go back to the previous slide. So in the pre-K, what you do is you can see they are doing letter A, where they are placing the beans on letter A, which means we are actually building the fine motor skills as well as they are learning the correct formation. They are very young to hold the pencil, so to develop their pencil grip in the beginning, we do activities like this with them, and then we transition them to holding a crayon and then to a pencil. If you see on the screen where the child has written three-letter words, within the line, if you can see, they have used within the line. That's how we teach our kids. So use the four lines between the lines. The capital letter touches the three lines and the small letters are written between the lines. So this is the outcome of an online learning. So our teachers are well trained for this, to take online classes and to teach handwriting as well. We do teach handwriting with the correct formation. Next slide, please. And now we are going to look into the numeracy, and over there also formation of numbers and everything. So if you see, they are using a lot of Play-Doh as well. Play-Doh helps in fine motor development. So they are achieving two things in one activity. They are developing their fine motor skill as well as they are learning numbers. They're learning to identify numbers. In fact, there are more to it actually. And see, they are using, like if you see, they are learning about tally marks. They're using, representing it through toothpicks. So it's easily available at home, and we ask the kids to bring whatever is available at home. If you see the picture which talks about, like if you can see in the first right-hand corner, the children are representing tally marks through their sketch pens, whatever they have at home. So, and then they even have a notebook where they learn to write between the check boxes. So this is how learning is being done. The math is being introduced in from pre-K to K2. And we do graphs with them. We tell them to collect information. That is the graph picture that you see. So collecting information is also a part of math. So that also is being done in the early years. Next slide, please. Now this is about fine motor skill development. Now over here, when we talk, not just fine motor skills are developed, but more to it, their communication skills are developed, because when they work on something, we just don't leave it as it is. Like you see, kids have created puppets. We just don't create puppet and leave it. They tell a story using the puppet. They do a role play with the puppets. So their communication skills are being developed over there. And if you see the first picture, they are the down pair. Left-hand side down picture, that you can see where they have rolled the Play-Doh and created patterns. Pattern again is a math concept. And then they are creating shapes and then they are painting. So all these are fine motor skill development. And even gardening, when they were learning about a unit on plants, they even they were sowing seeds. So all those are part of fine motor skill development. So, and in K2, and even as in K1 also, towards the end of K1, we teach our kids how to use scissors, of course, with an adult supervision, but they learn how to, like this gluing, this cutting, this digging, this painting, this rolling. It helps them develop their fine motor skills. Now, fine motor skill development plays a major role in the overall development of the child. And we ensure that we provide ample opportunities for our learners to reach this developmentally appropriate milestone. Next slide, please. Now I'll quickly take you through how a unit, like Ms. Kiran took you through how a unit is done in grade four. I will just quickly run through a unit, how is it done in grade K2. This is about K2. Ms. Kiran, next slide, please. Now we were looking into the theme of who we are, which we focus on the health and well-being of the students, the physical, the mental, and the emotional well-being of the students. Now, this unit is being done over the period of 8 weeks. So in this 8 weeks, the child has learned about physical, social, emotional health, which is covered under PSPE. And then they touched a little bit of science over there. And we learned about all these arts, dance, music, how it contributes to our well-being. So art, music, dance, everything was part of it. This and a lot of hands-on learning as well, a lot of play-based learning as well happen. Ms. Kiran, next slide, please. So if you see over here, the line of inquiry is about exploring choices. So they were learning about different choices that they have and how it is contributing to their health and well-being and what is the impact of the choices that they make. Our central idea, the main idea is the choices people make affect their health and well-being. So this is very, when you read it, it's too much for a K2 student to understand. So what we did initially was to pick out the keywords. Keywords, matlab, if you see in the central idea, the keyword is choices. They need to understand what choices are and then affect. So we picked the keyword affect, health, well-being. So we introduced them to all these terms for terminologies first, and then we take them through the journey for 8 weeks. Next slide, please. So the skills that they developed through this 8 weeks long unit is self-management skills, which is very important, though since it is the beginning of the year, they need to know how to manage their time. There are so many things that they have to work on, their fine motor skills, gross motor skills, and then they have to develop social skills so that they can interact with their peers. We give them opportunities in the class to interact with their peers. A lot of peer learning also happen, like we do a lot of peer assessment also where kids comment on the other child's learning. They give like positive feedback, like we train them how to look at the positive outlook of another child. And then the learner profile attribute of being caring, reflective, and being balanced, because they need to be balanced that to their confined to their four walls, and how they can be balanced, they can take care of their well-being. Next slide, please. And it is done through concepts. Again, concept gives the depth to the learning. So we focused on what are the what is well-being, and what are the impacts that it has on our what are the different choices that they make has an impact on our well-being. Next slide, ma'am. So again, as I said, we use the keywords to brainstorm, and those are see kids in the like since they can't, if it was a physical setting, we would have made them write. Of course, they wrote in their notebooks, but the teacher had to anecdote that, and the teacher has done it. So what is choice? And of course, the students have also written. Next slide, please. And then they were exploring about the choices they can make at home, the choices they can make at school, and then the choices they can make in the community. So we are connecting their learning with the world also. Next slide, please, ma'am. Now, we even had guest speakers. to talk about like healthy eating. See, of course, this pandemic in school, we make sure that they have a balanced meal. But what about home? They become very fussy at home also. But it is our duty, our responsibility to make our kids aware of the healthy eating habits. So we had a nutritionist come as a guest speaker to explain to our students the importance of healthy eating habits, and what are the healthy food that they can choose. Now, the kids went around in their house, or they can even cut pictures from the magazine about what they think. They were sorting about what are healthy food and what are junk food. And then if you see the second picture, they listen to the story about the hungry caterpillar, which again our English is covered over there because we are working on their listening skills. And then they're recording their observation from the book as through drawing. So that is again part of our English. And then they are collecting data, which is part of math, where they went around in their apartment to collect, okay, what food eat like their peers like, or their friends in the apartment like. Next. Now they had designed a balanced meal for them. So this is all kids' work, like what they want to have for breakfast, what they want to have for lunch, and what they want to have for dinner. So the kids chose, okay, what is, after the session with the nutritionist, they learned, okay, what are the healthy food, and they try to balance it out in the day-to-day meals. Next one, ma'am. And we talked about hygiene as well. So hygiene is very important. So they went around their house looking out in their houses of like which part of their houses are dirty or which is not. Like if you see the last picture, the child is saying it's stinking. So they learned, and they just didn't learn and leave it over there. They made sure that they cleared up the mess, or they learned to clean the space and everything. So they were becoming little detectives. So this is like play being enforced in their learning. So this is all part of play-based learning. And they even went around, took a survey. So now where to go during this pandemic? So they had to make phone calls or knock at the neighbor's house to find out information. They collected information. They interviewed three families, like about their choices. They wanted to know the choices that families make that contributes towards health and well-being. So these are the data gathered by our students, and they have represented it on a graph in their math notebooks. Next slide, please. And we even learned about well-being, how emotional, social, and physical well-being has to be looked into, even in the online setting, how we focused on this. Next one, ma'am. And their kids actually came up with the answer. So whatever you are seeing on screen, it's about whatever the child has said. See, when we were discussing about social well-being, they were saying helping mama and papa and no fighting, caring for animals, being friendly. All these are part of social well-being. And emotional well-being, they said reading, dance, meditation, playing with the family. All these are part of emotional. And physical well-being, of course, exercise, play, and everything, eating good food, healthy food, everything. And this is about the choices that they make and what will be the cause and the effect of the choices. Next slide, please. And finally, they reflect on their learning through pictures. Of course, they are starting to write. We give an option to write or to draw pictures. So they have chosen to draw pictures to replicate their understanding. Next slide, please. Now, this is in English. These are the topics that we have covered, like formation of letters and everything. I'll show you pictures of like what they have done. Next, ma'am. This is about math. And then transdisciplinary learning. This is where like our English is focused into, where they are learning to write sentence. And you can see, of course, see the formation of letters. This is about math. Next, ma'am. And then this is about how they are learning about how PE and dance contribute their well-being. And of course, how mindfulness. We have a session on mindfulness where it talks about the kids' meditation and all. We were doing it with the students, which contributes to well-being. And then music. And music also, how it contributes to well-being. I want you to also listen to it. Just a two-minute clip of another unit end reflection. This is not this unit end reflection because here they have drawn the picture. This is about a child sharing the learning experiences. Ms. Kiran, volume.
Is it audible, Ms. Rona?
Yes, yes. No, the volume is not there.
So can you please share it from your end then? I'm just close the sharing.
Can you see my screen?
Yeah, we can see just that video we wanted to view. That's it. Audio, Miss Rona, and make it full screen.
Rona, play the video separately. Don't play from the PPT.
And can you hear now?
Yes, it is. Make it full screen, Miss Rona.
Other animals.
What learner profile have you developed in this unit?
Kevin. For the animals. So they can also care for us. And we are happy.
நான் இப்ப பாரு நம்பர் எடுத்துட்டு
இருப்பேன் that you liked in this unit?
By learning about the animals and the habitat. Like camel lives in desert. In desert is a camel. There's a Fiddick fox and meerkat. In the cold, there is polar bear and penguin. In the farm, there's sheep, goat, cow, chicken, honeybee, then pig. All of them, the farmer takes care of them and clean them and look after them so they are safe. We should look after plants so all the animals are safe with us. Thank you.
What do you think you can do to help animals?
We can clean them. We can make food for them. We also can give water for them. And when we all do those things, the animals will help us. If we help animals, animals will help us.
So that is one of the reflection about one of the things that we did on animals. So, and I want to end with a quote with a Chinese proverb that say, tell me and I forget, show me and I remember. Involve me and I understand. That's exactly what we do at Candor, is to involve the students in their learning so that they understand and they learn to connect with the real world and to become better citizens of the world. Thank you. Over to Ms. Kiran.
Thank you, Ms. Rina Aruna. That's a wonderful journey into early years. So now I hand it over to Ms. Srishti so that she can open the forum for interaction. Over to you, Srishti. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Ms. Rona. Thank you, Ms. Kiran, for sharing all the aspects of primary and early years program. We are going to begin with interactive session now. Our speakers, Ms. Kiran, Ms. Rona, and our principal, Ms. Kavita Sinha, will address your questions. So firstly, I will take the questions from the chat box. I hope majorly has been answered. There was a few questions from Ms. Sandhya that, you know, she has witnessed the last academic year. It was a great effort and school, and will the same sort of schedule continue next academic term, and when will it begin? And she's also asking about how, when the class grade one will start, and she just wanted to know something about grade one. Am I right, Ms. Sandhya? You can unmute yourself.
Yeah, I just want to know about grade one classes and when it's going to start, and entire schedule about grade one.
Ms. Kiran, do you want to take that?
Yeah, may I answer? Yes. Srishti?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Ms. Sandhya?
Yeah.
We are going to end this academic year by May 29, May 30. So once the academic year is done, you will be receiving a complete info about the schedule for the next academic year, the beginning of your classes and the complete schedule. And the planner also will be sent to you well in advance, Ms. Sandhya. So we are just about to finish the academic year, and we will be updating you about the beginning of the new academic year very soon. Okay?
Sure, sure. Thank you. Like how you explained about K1 and K2, I just thought I can have a scheduled explanation about grade one.
I would love to do that, Ms. Sandhya, but you know, this is of a time constraint, but anytime you can just get in touch with the admin team. We will always there to take you through that learning. No problem, Ms. Sandhya, anytime.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
That's it.
Thank you, Ms. Sandhya. We have one more doubts from Mr. Bharat, and he wanted to know how the school will be like and how we are teaching our pre-K and K1 students online, and steps to handle this. Mr. Bharat, can you unmute yourself? And
Yes, sure. So my kid, he hasn't seen school as yet. He don't know what school is, and to start off with, we just open the laptop or tab. We tell them, here's your teacher, and then you have to start learning. So I just wanted to know how you tackle that situation. Yeah. How do we make the kids sit in front of the device, yeah, and make him learn?
I will take this question at the beginning, that when we start with a pre-K student, first there is something known as settlement time. It's one-to-one where the teacher will give a call. And for 15 to 20 minutes, it will be a group call where the child will get familiar to the student and to the teacher. And then we also send some kind of, corner in the house, which can be created as a school learning space. A separate desk, a separate chair, a small little chart. All these instructions will be given by the primary years coordinator and early years coordinator. And it will not happen instantly. It takes 2 to 3 weeks for the child to get into it. So usually the rhyme and the circle time starts first, where they actually interact. And I think, Ms. Rona, you can continue from here as how you do it.
Yeah, the same way, ma'am. As like I mentioned in my presentation also, that's how we settle in the kids. We have a one-on-one interaction with the kids. We do a lot of, like, kids already know rhymes already. Even in the house, they would have been exposed to rhymes. So we start from there, like sing along with them. And a lot of interaction happens before we actually begin the lessons.
We take it at their space. It is not, yes, that this is the time plan and you have to connect to us one-to-one with a coordinator and let us know what's happening at home. And then accordingly, we fix a time and we start our interaction. It is a very, very open-minded school. So we are very flexible.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Kavita. So Ms. Meera has also a similar question related to virtual and physical classroom. Ms.
Hello.
Yeah.
There's a small question to you, okay? My question is whether the virtual class is effective or what? Why can't you go with offline class, like sending worksheets, those things like that?
So we would love to go back to offline classes, and we are looking forward to it, but we are aware under the government restrictions, till we get a confirmed notation from the government saying that we can open the school, we will do it. There's nothing from the school side which has not been done. We are completely prepared to handle offline classes, but it is just waiting for the government's direction.
No, I mean, my question is, I mean, can you send the worksheets to like to WhatsApp to the parents, right? I mean, like a simple worksheets like alphabet A, B, rhymes.
See, there, like, there is a kind of instructions which we will send in the planner, and they don't start writing alphabet. See, every parent is thinking that they can manage to teach the child, but let's give credit to the professionals, because we know exactly when we have to introduce sand tracing, when we have to use the homemade suji rava to actually use tracing. So everybody thinks we know it all and we can just make the child learn ABCD and 1 to 100, but that's not the process, sir. The phonetics has to be done. There are skills involved, motor skills involved, and that's why leave it to the professionals to handle it, and they will take it slowly, firmly, and at the pace of the child. That's the reason. And virtually it is happening. It takes little time initially. Patience is required, but we will do it for you all. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. And we have one more question from Ms. Sushmi. Would like to know, how is the learning shared with parents? Do they have assessments?
So I'll take it up this question with your permission, ma'am. So
yes,
that's a wonderful question, actually. I think it will be answering a lot of queries also along with that. So how do we inform the learning? This is also an integral part of the process, because as parents, you're all the valuable and valued partners in the learning as well. So updating and informing about the learning as a process for us. Before we begin the inquiry, as I told you, the 10-day cyclic planner, before we begin the planner, 10-day cycle, you will be receiving a complete planner, a day-to-day schedule for each lesson. How is it going to be happening in the classroom? This is for every grade and every subject. As per the timetable, it has been set and sent to the parents. And once you receive that, at the end of the 10th day, that is 10-day cycle is done, you will be receiving a newsletter with the complete information. The process of learning the child has gone through will be documented with the pictures and evidences and will be shared with you. That will give you clear insight into the planner, what your resident, how the learning process has gone through it. Apart from this, before beginning the unit of inquiry, that is, as I told you, unit of inquiry goes for 6 weeks. So before we begin the inquiry, a week before, we will be sending a complete info, which is called as a SOW scheme of work, in which all the subjects have been clearly mentioned. And how is this going to be dealt in the coming 6 weeks is clearly mentioned with the learning objectives, and it will be sent to the parents. So before the planning and after the planning and through the learning process, you are being updated. There's another question added to it was about assessments. As assessments are ongoing for us. We don't create assessment in such a buzz that, you know, more than the child, the tension and stress is for parents, and unknowingly automatic stress is transformed to the kids. So even from my child, I have experienced it. My parents used to stay awake the whole night and get an exam, read. So that I really feel blessed that this program has given been reached to the children out there. For them, they don't even feel that they've been assessed, but they know what is being assessed. They know how to give out the reflection. That's a wonderful journey. So they don't never feel, they don't get scared. So for them, assessment is celebration. I know I'm going to share it. I don't know. It's okay. It's okay. I'm going to learn. So that's the beauty of this primary years program. That flexibility is there in this program. So there is no stress, no fear, especially that's why we don't call exams. Assessment, celebration of the learning. That's it. I think Ms. Sushmi, I've answered your question.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Hi, ma'am. Can I ask one question?
I would like to add, your parents, I want you all to contribute in the learning of your child by actually sitting and talking to them about your culture, your pastime, your history. This is the best time that we are all in the phase of lockdown, and you can spend some time talking about history. Leave the learning to us. We are the professionals. We will hold hands. We will do the learning part. You contribute us with your stories, your culture, because that makes the learning so rich and so insightful. That's the only request I can give. Tell parents that please do this from your side. We are here to be partners in education.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Jyoti, you can please.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, since we are listening that the schedule is from 9 to 3:30, and I'm sure most of us are the working, you know, parents as well. So this 9 to 3:30 of slot, definitely parent would not be able to sit throughout because of the work and other stuff. What is the actual requirement, and as per your experience, how much time that parent has to spend with the child in order to make the full use of, you know, the studies which are students are taking it individually, and I'm talking about the 5 years old kid.
I mean,
yes, Miss Rona.
Yes, yes, ma'am. In the early years, we start at 9 o'clock, and we are done with our synchronous class by 11:55. After that, we have only asynchronous work, which will be posted. You can do it after your office hours also in the evening with the students. But we have 35 minute slot where we post like hands-on. It is a follow-up work of what is actually taught during the synchronous class. So three synchronous class we have. One begins at 9 o'clock, the other one is at 10 o'clock, and the other one is at 11:15.
You have time, ma'am, to actually space your things out, because after 11:55, it's basically, you can say, a recap, a reflection of what you're doing, and the child need not finish it between the time given. The laptop is not required, the gadget is not required, and you can do it throughout the day. So basically, as working parents, if not even working parents, we have to do multitasking at this time. So you have to be there initially for, I will say, 1 week. I've seen the progress in grade 5. Slowly from the second week, they know how to mute, unmute, everything they do. Please understand, they are born with technology. We are migrating. So as parents, I understand we are all experiencing it for the first time. It's learning for you all. Give them that freedom. They will do it for the second week themselves. So don't get worried. And if there is some kind of issues, problem, connect to our teachers immediately. They'll find a solution. We are here to solve your problems. Thank you,
ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Mom, small question now. Actually, my child is staying in Nagarbhavi, which comes over in like towards in Magdi Road. Okay, I mean, one of my friend referred your school. So I'm interested to join your school now. What if the school start in middle?
Which grade is that?
Nursery.
Middle means you want to start now? Now the session is ending. So
he's talking about starting
admission,
physical classes.
Yes.
Admission online now. And if the school reopens physically, what can we do? Because he's staying far away.
Far away from the school.
Very tricky question, sir. We can support you with online classes. Okay. We can definitely get back to you. And from grade 4, we have residential school. So I would say, talk to our admission team. Get on board from July end. Take the advantage. Okay. Looks like, I should not be saying out loud loudly, but looks like our online classes are going to continue for the pre-primary for at least, you know, a couple of months. Take advantage, and we'll talk to the admissions how we do things further. But take the advantage of whatever you're getting now, and slowly let's see what we can do. But definitely, there are no transport going to Nagarbhavi. We'll be spending the whole day. But please take advantage of whatever we have to offer on online. That's all I could say.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good morning, rather good afternoon. This is Rajshekhar here. I'm a father of a kid looking for a third grade 3 admission. Okay, so I'm just worried on the seamless integration that can happen, because he's studying in an ICSE. Okay, and I typically feel that he's not good enough at the English language. So what could be the help that you can do for the seamless integration of my kid into your org?
We have something known as mentoring and support, which is embedded within the curriculum. So, sir, you don't need to get stressed. He's in grade 3, and if he doesn't know, he has time to learn, and we will support, because we believe in differentiated learning. So he will not even feel left out. He'll be motivated. He'll be confident enough because we will design the curriculum according to what it is. But it will not happen automatically. My teachers will need at least 2 weeks to assess, to know where he is, and then pick up the strings from there and help him out. It's not an issue at all. And that's why we say international curriculum is so robust.
Okay.
Not an issue at all. We will be supporting in-house. You don't need any tuitions, please. Mm-hmm. Absolute no to tuitions. We will do the job. My teachers, under the able leadership of my coordinators, will do it.
Yeah, ma'am. From the academic perspective, I don't see any challenges. It's good enough. But only thing is, from the compilation, the language, the literature, and the level of understanding, you showed me an example of the government system, which little stepped me aback because it's a totally big concept. I'm feeling that my kid may not be able to digest that.
Sir,
that's where I have a challenge.
So you should not get worried about seeing an example, because you should understand each one runs at their own pace.
Correct.
Yep. That's what is differentiation. Yep. Because this is what we want to bring it to the table, that please, education cannot be one for all. That's where people start going for tuitions and they start finding subjects so tough. So you are assured at Kando that your child will start building.
Joining IB and sending for a tuition doesn't make any sense, because I don't feel anyone will teach an IB concepts to the kids outside.
They're outside.
Typical. Anywhere.
No. They do it. They do it. What I want to also break a myth in the parents' mind. It's always, if I'm putting my child to international curriculum, does it mean that after grade 12, the child takes a flight and straight away goes abroad? No, sir.
All the exams
they can take up, everything in India they can do. Their research skills gets very, very fine-tuned. Their creativity is at a higher level. They are able to understand analytical analysis they're able to do, and they're away from the rote learning. Having said that, we cannot say that we should not have memory at all. We should also develop that, and we have it within the curriculum.
I buy that. And this only challenge is that integration into the system.
Not as the issue. There is something which we can do for you. I can tell you that something which we can do is we have something known as Bridge Program, which my coordinator is completely aware. And whatever she has done in grade 2, we put it as a folder and we send it across to the parents and we hold their hands so that, you know, during the summer break, a little bit you can do it. And the coordinator will let you know how to do it. Kiran, can you please take it up from here?
Yeah, thank you, actually. Thank you so much. Mr. Shikhar, let me tell you something. What I have shown you is the end product.
Okay.
To get that product, the children have gone through a process of 6 weeks and more than that. So when you look at the children at the beginning of the learning, they are raw. They are new to this unit.
Okay.
So, I think your child's name is Lakshya, if I'm not wrong. So the beginning, the Lakshya is new to the entire. So that is why if you have seen it, we were brainstorming on the keywords. What is government? What is a system? What is interconnectedness? From there, they started and they have come to the case study of certain countries. So they have come a very long way. And the teacher, the parents together play a role here. So the teacher facilitates, gives the resources for the children. And as I told you in the beginning also, there will be hand-holding from the teacher if it is required for the child. So we sit with one-on-one to understand what exactly his challenges he's facing and where you think is the little difficulty for him to move on. And then, because, you know, challenges differ from person to person. So we cannot just fit in one measurement to everybody here. As Ms. Kavita was also mentioning, differentiated learning. So we will understand in the beginning. So how familiar he is with these words. So a little extra hand-holding, it will also be given. And they will be given complete resources so that they understand. And trust me, when you sit for another orientation with us, you will be seeing the same process again, and your child will be the one who is taking you through that process.
Okay.
So it is just end product. So don't get worried or panicky about the government system. No, we will bring them from the word of government to the case study. And trust me, that's a beautiful journey. 6 weeks is enough time for any child to get through it. And there is another thing you are discussing is that integration of subjects. He don't even realize that, you also don't even realize as a parent, how to do with this mathematics and all. It's a smooth flow. So as Ms. Sushmi questioned me, how the parents will be informed. So you will get a complete note before the unit. What are the things will be dealt in English, math, science, social, every language, every single subject. So you are aware
that,
of it. Yeah. So you will be taken through that process. And cyclic planner, I told you, everything is in again, minute to minute, the cyclic planner tells you what happens in each day, in each grade, each class. So I don't think there will be any difficulty because the function, just the transition goes so smoothly with your son as well. It's only we get scared. How is it? The children, they love challenges. And they will teach us now when they've just come into the IB, they will teach us big, big jargons and words. And it's a kind of lot of learning happens from both ends. We teachers learn from them and they also learning happens to and fro. So Mr. Shekhar, relax. It's okay. We will be taking care of the child's transition and the learning as well. Okay?
Yeah. Thanks for your, thanks for all your help. Yeah.
Thank you,
ma'am.
Thank you. Okay,
Srishti, should we?
Yes. Ma'am, you're not audible.
Any other question? They can always connect one to one through admissions, but I think we have short our time. So, yes. What's the next?
So, thank you, parents. If you have any questions, you can just write to us and you can connect with the admission department. Meanwhile, please also fill the feedback form about the session, so that we can have more information about how we are doing it and how well we can get more interactive session for you in future. And please get in touch with us. We are coming up with a middle year open house soon, so stay in touch with us. Thank you everyone. Miss Usha, can you take it forward from here?
Thank you, Miss Srishti. Dear parents, yes, we are posting the feedback on the chat box again. So all your queries, you can post it there. We, the admissions teams, are always there to answer and handhold regarding the languages and many more. So I'd like to thank, I thank our respected principal, Ms. Kavita Sinha, who graced us with her presence and guidance. Thank you, ma'am, for sharing with us your words of wisdom. Thank you, our dear coordinators, Ms. Kiran and Ms. Rona, for sharing your knowledgeable insights. My sincere gratitude goes out to all parents for making time in your busy schedules to join us here this morning. If you have further questions, as I mentioned, please write to us, share it on the feedback forms that's shared on the chat box. We are here to help you. We are here to handhold for sure. We would like to culminate our today's session with a Candor School song followed by National Anthem. I would request everyone to please stand up for the national anthem. Thank you.
Preparing us for life, oh Candor School, through love, respect, concern.
Stay home, stay safe, stay healthy. Have a wonderful weekend and a pleasant day. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. Wait to see you all soon at our campus.